The following is a Mid-Atlantic Sports special presentation.
Welcome to the Carolina Sports Arena, and welcome to CWF Mid-Atlantic Wrestling.
It may not be a national holiday, but you better believe everyone had it circled on their calendars all year long. Tonight is October 14th, and tonight is the night of nights, because tonight is the return of the Rumble. Plus, Brass Monkey defends the Mid-Atlantic television title. The AWA World Heavyweight Champion is back, and the first Rick Converse is live and in action. There's never been a match like it in CWF history, and there may never be again, and it's not for the squeamish. It's for sole possession of the Weaver Cup. It's Gemini Kid versus Kamikaze Kid, and it's Kazi's rules.
Tonight, the Johnny Weaver Cup is coming back to the Gemini Kid. Kamikaze, you stole that trophy. You stole it from me. You didn't win it, right? Scientific rules, you had your feet on the ropes. Everybody saw it, but these fans, I don't know what's wrong with them. They're turning their back on me, but tonight, I'm getting that trophy back. I gotta do it in a Kazi rules match. Tables, chairs, and by God, thumbtacks! You think you're backing me into the corner? You're the one that's gonna pay tonight. Don't think you're pulling one on me on that. You see, I got a lot of friends. I've been around for a long time. Gemini Kid's been on his razor. He's been talking to his friends that know how to get extreme. And tonight, you think you're putting me in some thumbtacks? I'm walking out of here with that trophy cup, and Kamikaze Kid, you won't be walking at all.
Can Joey Sylvia shake the label of choke artist as he takes on the Boogie Woogie Man, Rob McBride, for the Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight title?
Who must it tonight? CWF Rumble, baby. It's on like a pot of neck bone. Boogie Woogie Man versus Joey Sylvia. One more again. And you know, Joey, people's asking me, they're saying, Boogie, is this the night that the music dies? Or is this the night that we're going to be boogie woogieing all night long, baby? You got Scuba Steve in your corner. All my brothers and sisters say, Boogie, the odds are stacked against you. Joey got peoples in his corner. I got peoples in my corner. I got each and every one of you, brothers and sisters. So there's no way, baby. There's no way that the Boogie Man can lose. Because Joey Sylvia, I'm going to tell you something right now, Daddy. The only way you're going to take the middle act title away from me and from my peoples is you're going to have to kill me. You got to kill me dead. You hear what I'm saying to you? You got to kill me dead, Daddy!
And finally, 30 wrestlers all vying for one goal. That one goal is to get a shot at any title of their choosing. It's the one night of the year wrestlers live for. It's the most incredible 30 minutes of wrestling on the entire calendar year. It's the Rumble. It's the night where some dreams will die, but others will believe again.
Right here in my hand, I have a little bit of AWA business to take care of. Anybody that knows what has been going on here lately, not just here, but in AWA worldwide, we know that we had a situation come up where Xyrus won the World Light Heavyweight title. He pinned Kirby Mack, Crazy K, as you know, in the middle of the ring, in West Virginia, in Charleston, West Virginia, just a couple months ago. There was controversy because the original referee was not down. The president of the AWA, Mr. Dale Gagne himself, rolled in the ring, made the count, awarded the title belt to Xyrus. Then the referee came in and said, no, it's not going to happen like that. I was hit. I was knocked out of the ring by Xyrus and awarded the belt back to Crazy K.
Give it!
To stop a civil war within the AWA, what we have, ladies and gentlemen, is different territories recognizing Xyrus as the World Light Heavyweight Champion. Then we have different territories recognizing Crazy K. The problem with this is that I feel there should only be one. The board thought it would be best at this time to have two disputed light heavyweight champions. to keep the peace. I don't like it myself, but to keep the peace, this is what they wanted to do. Mr. Gagne sent me a little care package for you. I wish it was a little bit more celebratory here, but let me present you with this.
Longer than out of time.
Ladies and gentlemen, like I say, this is not undisputed. There are, at this time, two world light heavyweight champions. I don't like it. I think it should be settled here in the ring, but congratulations. Let's hear it for Osiris.
It's been a while.
Crazy K, we've had numerous battles. He's probably the greatest and hardest opponent I've fought, and I wish we could do it another way, and I hope this matter gets resolved soon. But until then, I'm the light heavyweight champion.
There is one thing I want to say though. Since you wanted to interrupt me, I'll let you say a couple things, and then I'll finish making my announcement.
I think I have a little more than just a couple to say, Commissioner Cross, with all due respect. Now, you've used that word disputed a lot tonight, but the only dispute there is you said your AWA light heavyweight champion of the world, Osiris. Possession is 9/10 of the law, and well, that's not the AWA light heavyweight title. This is. Now, some people out there might not understand exactly what's going on, so I'm gonna take you on a little journey through time. It won't be long, I promise. No, it won't. You see, Dad Gagne wants to have a personal vendetta against me. Why? Because I did something that everybody else in the back would have done. I took an opportunity, and I went and worked for the other guys. Brandon, they kicked my butt.
Good,
but you know what? Hey, how many times have you been on national TV? That's the only thing I tried to say. Now, it's been argued back and forth. You had me pinned to the mat. You were able to hit your DUI. That is true. That was a success. But you then also deliberately kicked the referee, and you had Del Gagne come in and count the quickest three count I've ever heard in the history of wrestling.
See, that's where you're wrong. I had nobody come in. The fact of the matter is, it doesn't matter who made the three count. The fact is that my finisher pins you 1, 2, 3.
What you think, but the fact of the matter is, over a year and a half ago, I was here in CWF and I beat a 30-man tournament. And you guys can think what you want of me, but weekend after weekend, I travel the country to try to prove to the world that the AWA and that the CWF is not just some second-rate indie fan. I bust my butt in the ring with my blood, sweat, and tears for all of you, for each and every one of you, and I'm gonna tell you what. Every night of the week, but I will continue to do that. You gotta understand, it's a perfect night for it to be Fan Appreciation Night, because I didn't come here to start trouble. I just came here to let Dal Gagne know that unless you're God himself, you're not taking this title off of me with no second-rate thing like this. I have made history. No, not him. Not him. The controversy. I have made history. I'm the longest running AWA light heavyweight champion. And if we have to settle it, then we have to settle it right. We don't just settle it over the internet with a couple of shoot comments about how, oh, I slid in and I'm the president of AWA, so I don't want you to represent my company, so you're not going to. That's not how it's going to go down. No. Dal Gagne, I don't care how many three-way matches you put me in or how many guys you pull to the side and you ask them, hey, lay it in a little extra hard on Crazy K tonight. That doesn't matter, because you got to understand something now. I don't run on blood. I run on my fans. That's my support system. As long as I have that, you bring whatever you've got.
That's how you want. You think this is how I wanted to win the AWA light heavyweight title? It's not. I want to do it the right way. I want to do it where there are no second guesses. There are no questions or concerns about who's the true champion. I want you on one side, me on the other side, and whatever else needs to happen, happen. But I want to do it right, one-on-one. One champion to another.
Nothing but respect.
This isn't about titles and who holds what belt. This, no, it isn't. This is about proving who can beat who. It's ours. We've been around this world circle time after time, and you will give me one heck of a fight. But I think not only do we need to prove to ourselves, but we owe it to all these people to let them know who the lightweight heavyweight champion is.
Hey, Cyrus, you make a good point, and yes, you did pin him to the mat. I have reviewed the tape. I know it to be fact. You make a valid point. I would like to see it done right here in the middle of the ring myself. So I tell you this, before you interrupted me, I was about to tell you that December 2nd at the AWA convention, right here in Burlington, North Carolina, those undisputed titles won't be disputed anymore because they're going to be settled right here in this ring, right here that night, when all the AWA comes together right here in this building from all 32 territories. Going to be right here, and it's going to be that belt and that belt, and there's only going to be one champion, and that's the way it should be.
Welcome everyone to the Carolina Sports Arena, coming to you from Burlington, North Carolina.
It's CWF Mid-Atlantic, the fastest half hour of pro wrestling anywhere in the world, especially here on the internet at high speed. You're seeing the television champion Brass Monkey in black and gold here, working on the wrist of Mr. Elite Jake Manning in his 10-minute television time limit match.
Of course, Brass Monkey has been one of the finest television champions we've had in quite some time, ever since he dethroned Michael McAllister for that championship. Brass Monkey has been the epitome of a fighting champion, and Jake Manning, no slouch himself, we should have a tremendous contest on hand for the television title.
But did you say fighting champion or biting champion?
Fair enough, as Brass Monkey certainly has been known to take a bite out of crime. Now and again, our official for this television title contest, referee Katie Kincaid.
That's right, Brass Monkey showing some of that agility that he's learned somewhere other than on a jungle gym in the backyard. These young men both giving it their all out here, wide open, beautiful arm drags. Monkey trying to take it to Mr. Elite.
Brass Monkey certainly rocking the world of Mr. Elite Jake Manning here in the early going in front of the packed house here at the CSA reversal by Manning. Catches Monkey's spine buster.
That's going to leave a mark. That will slow down the TV champion, but Jake Manning needs to make a move to take advantage of the situation. Finally got the leg over for the cover. Only a two count.
This is our first lateral press of this contest, but Jake Manning still has a lot of work to do before trying to pin the shoulders of Brass Monkey's shoulders to the canvas. As we've mentioned so many times in the past, Brass Monkey almost has the look of a light heavyweight, a cruiserweight, but certainly over the years has proven himself to be able to hold his own against a man any size here at CWF.
Yeah, you're talking about any size. We have seen another individual that's in and out of CWF, a former champion, performing that same maneuver on Brass Monkey and end up losing the match. I mean, who could forget the stretcher match with Corey Edsel from a year or so back? We thought Monkey was dead in that match.
Brass Monkey has certainly earned his stripes over the years, and his first singles championship, this television title, has been a long time in the making. A lot of people thought he probably deserved singles gold before then, but he's proving it throughout 2006. That good things come to those who wait.
That's right, Brass Monkey down face first on the canvas. Ran into it high speed by Jake Manning. Manning's got him down. Monkey's able to kick out on two again.
Ever since that spine buster, the reversal there, Jake Manning has had this contest in firm control. And Jake Manning, you have to think that he fits the mold of a television champion to near perfection himself as far as all the attributes, the abilities that great professional wrestlers that have held the television title in the past have had.
Well, that, and you've got to also mention, even though it's not that major, I mean, he's able to kick out on two on that one. Manning back in with a clothesline monkey down, but I was going to say, Manning's got a weight advantage over Brass Monkey, and he's starting to use that right now.
That last clothesline caught Brass Monkey, looked right across the bridge, the nose possibly, and now Manning, very cocky cover, more interested in posing for the camera than he was actually pinning his opponent.
Yeah, Brass Monkey still down and looks to be in a world of hurt. I'm not sure if he knows where he's at, but here we go. Going to work on a reverse chin lock here. Referee Katie Kincaid in close, going to make sure this is not a choke. She says it's okay to go.
Very smart wrestling on the behalf of Mr. Elite Jake Manning, but it also brings up the constant problem in these television title matches because you've only got 10 minutes to work with and you don't know, have the time to wear down your opponent like you would in, say, a 30-minute time limit.
That's right. Brass Monkey, knowing this, he's off the ropes with Mr. Elite. He was waiting on him again. Brass Monkey once again face down on the canvas.
Brass Monkey clutching the lower abdomen as Jake Manning towers over him. Jake Manning being very methodical, and we keep reiterating so many times the 10-minute time limit because how many times in the past have we seen that come into play in these championship matches?
Well, that's right, but you know, Brass Monkey, not like his predecessors, not one to dive out to the floor, you know, several times during a match and demand a countdown of how much time's left. He stays in the ring. I mean, this is a fighting champion.
Yeah, Brass Monkey, he may run into the problem with the 10-minute time limit draw, but unlike Michael McAllister, he will never be running trying to use the clock to his advantage.
That's right. Jake Manning has got to be aware of the time in this match. Going for the cover again, only able to get a two count. You know, there, and here we go. I mean, he's going to complain to the referee a little bit, go back to the chin lock, smart wrestling, but you know, he's got to keep his mind on the time.
Jake Manning really grinding away on the neck of Brass Monkey, who's trying to pull that forearm away from his throat.
I tell you what, Manning, you're running a smart match so far. Brass Monkey trying to get back to a vertical base, finally able to get a little leverage for an elbow to the midsection, frees himself, and delivers some kicks.
Some of the most dangerous kicks in the Mid-Atlantic, and that last one caught Manning right in the back of the head, and Monkey continues on the onslaught. Kicks, forearm, but yet another reversal by Jake Manning, utilizing the power of Monkey, slips from behind, back cracker on Jake Manning.
Oh my goodness, he's getting tied up in his variation of what, a dragon sleeper?
Yes, it is, and he's wrenching back on it. He won the television title,
it's over.
And he's going to retain the television title here today following the back cracker dragon sleeper combination.
That's right. An impressive submission win, and he's still AWA Mid-Atlantic Television Champion, Brass Monkey.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, you're winner by pinfall in 7 minutes 55 seconds, and still your AWA Mid-Atlantic Television Champion, Brass Monkey!
You know, I wish I could be in better spirits coming out in front of all y'all tonight, but the fact of the matter is, I'm not. You see, I like what was said in the little video deal before the show, saying that how tonight would be where some dreams die and others begin again. Well, my dream died a month ago when Michael Yamaha walked out on the CWF, because tonight was supposed to be my night. Tonight was supposed to be me and Mike. No rules, anything goes, but that didn't happen now, did it?
Nope. He's kind of recruiting like the Raiders.
So tonight, since my dream, my goal has died, another one begins. You see this number right here? It's the number 29. I drew this number as we were doing the drawings for the CWF Rumble tonight, And while most people seeing this number out of 30 would be very happy, I am not. So this is what I'm gonna do right now. I'm gonna leave here, I'm gonna go to the back, and I'm gonna find Commissioner Cross. Then I'm gonna find whoever has got number one. Tonight, for the first time, you will see someone enter number one and walk out here the champion of the CWF Rumble. And if you think I'm kidding, that's funny, because I'm not. I guarantee a win tonight. I'm serious. I'm going to win the CWF Rumble tonight. I don't care which one of those other 29 bozos come out there. I'm going to punch them in the mouth. I'm going to kick them in the face, and I'll bite them, because I don't care tonight. Matty D is going to be the 6th annual CWF Rumble champion. I promise you. Thank you.
Well, Randolph, the AWA World Heavyweight Champion himself, the first Rick Culvers, has returned home.
That's right, and in the ring, still got the coat and the belt on. Young Bobby Fonta attacking the champion, but it's not fazing him a bit.
Following the footsteps of the Bockwinkles, the Hennings, the Ganyas, so many greats in this sports history, the first Rick Culvers is the AWA World Heavyweight Champion in the year 2006. And right now, he's taking it to Bobby Fonta in front of his hometown fans here in Burlington, North Carolina.
Bobby Fonta, he's the one that brought this on himself. He started this match before the bell, and now he's having to pay the price for we've been just a little bit lenient in his count, but I'm telling you, the champ's chopping away on him, going to drag him around and show what he can do on his chest to all the fans here in the Carolina Sports Arena.
The AWA World Heavyweight Champion is on fire. It was nearly 1 year ago in this very building that Bobby Fonta was actually one of Michael McAllister's hired henchmen to try and eliminate Rick Culvers from the CWF Rumble, a rumble that Culvers won and led him on a pathway that ended with him winning the AWA World Heavyweight title on June 14, 2006 in Indianapolis by pinning the shoulders of Taka Mori.
And I tell you what, you look at him, you see how he goes in the ring, how he goes from one move to the next. This is what it takes to be World Heavyweight Champion. You don't see any hesitation. He got the two count. He didn't turn around and argue with the referee or make a comment to the crowd. He went right back to his opponent.
Rick Culvers runs straight through. Bobby Fonta leaps over. Fonta tries for a hip toss, but Culvers having nothing at all to do with it.
That's right. Bobby Fonta holding the back now in the ropes. Culvers right back straight to the face again on this young man.
Of course, ever since Culvers won the world title, he's been on a very rigorous schedule, taking on all comers from greats like Dustin Rhodes, Heidenreich, so many entertainment superstars, and even some of the great homegrown talent like the massive Otto Schwanz. But right now, Bobby Fonta has turned the tide.
I tell you what, Bobby Fonta has. He's turned this thing around. This could be big, big news if something was to happen and Culvers got lost by a pinfall to someone that we really don't know here in his hometown?
Well, certainly this is a non-title match, but the ramifications of a loss here to Culvers would be mammoth, but a clothesline takes the head off of Fonta and ends that flurry real quick.
Yeah, the champ's got a second win, and he's going right back straight to the face of this young man. Right now, it's probably not a good idea to be Bobby Fonta.
In front of all these fans, over the years, Culvers has become a star here in the Mid-Atlantic. But it wasn't until June 14th that Culvers proved he's not only a star here in the Mid-Atlantic, he's a star all over the world by pinning Taka Mori. And now Culvers leaps, catches Fonta again.
Fonta was up off his feet, finally trying to get back to a vertical base. And it was just a two count on that. I thought that one was over.
Hey, let's give a round of applause to Bobby Fonta for having the heart to actually kick out.
That's right, because he's had it taken right back to him for three quarters this match. And right now, Culvers is going for the death shot. This one should be over shortly. Culvers rushes in, back elbow. Looks like Fonta was able to defend that one.
But Fonta's still alive and runs right into the sky-high power bomb, and Culvers calling for it. calling for the fans here at the CSA, and you better believe they want one thing only, and that is the Richter scale.
You know that's what he's looking for right now. Bobby Fonda still having a hard time trying to get to his feet. It's over, says the champion, and here we go. Oh, back elbow into the back of the head of the champion.
What an effort by Bobby Fonda with Conner's Dutchman. Drives the head into the knee, and could we have it this time? Has him up.
And he's got him up in the Richter scale. Watch this. This is how you win titles.
Converse with the leg hook, the three count, and the AWA World Heavyweight Champion, the first Rick Converse, returns home to the CSA in very convincing fashion.
It is great to be in Burlington tonight! And to be here for one of the most prestigious shows in this whole company. The CWF Rumble is such an important match for whoever wins it. Because 1 year ago, right here, I was the winner of the CWF Rumble. And that was the first win that started to skyrocket in me all the way to the World Heavyweight title. So tonight, for whoever it is out of those 30 guys who wins the CWF Rumble, hey, all you got is a bunch of great things that are coming for you. So I'm telling you, living proof right here.
You're looking at your worst nightmare.
That's a grown man.
You see it. Hey, you shut up and sit back. I came here last month looking for you, but it seemed like you got word that I was coming and you had to go do a family thing. Hey, when you're world champion, everything, and I mean everything, including family, takes a back seat, chump. Well, I got you here face to face. You're looking at the best. You see, NWA Virginia sent me here because I'm going to take that belt and I'm going to take it back to a real organization.
If you take that belt, I'll be your dad.
I don't know if you know it yet, but my people at NWA Virginia got the paperwork from your people October 28th. This belt is going around the waist of a real champ. You want to stay in the rumble tonight? You want to stay in the rumble tonight? Get in the back.
Get in the back.
Get in the back where you belong. Loser! 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 Loser!
In a promotion built on tradition, in one match, those values could very well be ripped apart, along with the physical beings of the two participants. Hailed as the patriarch of CWF Mid-Atlantic, the Gemini Kid has long upheld the banner that proclaims tradition. But as he enters uncharted territory and his true colors begin to show, is he truly upholding the banner of tradition or merely hiding behind it? And now, in a quest to recapture the most prized trophy in all the Mid-Atlantic, the Gemini Kid must enter a match where tradition has been tossed aside and the only rules are Kazi's rules. No one has sacrificed their body more over the years than the Kamikaze Kid, but tonight, with Kazi rules and thumbtacks and tables and ladders and chairs being legal, tonight Kamikaze Kid will look to sacrifice someone else's body for the sole possession of the Weaver Cup. Gemini Kid, Kamikaze Kid, Kazi's rules.
The Gemini Kid is going to put you down. 1, 2, 3. And I'm walking out with my trophy that I won. I'm the champion. And tonight I'm going to be the champion with this trophy. And I'm going to end your career and take that mask off so everyone in here can see what a loser looks like. I am so confident. I'll tell you what, lady. I'll tell you what. Just for you. This is for you. Listen. You listen. If I don't beat him tonight, I'll get down on my hands and knees right here in this ring and kiss his boots. That's how short. That's for you. That's for you. But I'm not getting in that ring until that chair. Because it's going to be a wrestling match, despite what all you crazy people want. It's going to be a wrestling match. It's not going to be tables and chairs.
Well, Randolph, we don't even really know what to expect in this one, except to expect the unexpected, because it is Kazi's rules. Kamikaze Kid versus the Gemini Kid.
That's right. Look at this. Kazi's got the chair, and the race is on. Gemini making a retreat away from the on-rushing Kamikaze Kid. Veteran Sandy drops the boots on Kazi as he tries to enter the ring, and look, he's holding a chair. He tossed it out.
He tossed it out because Gemini Kid wants to have absolutely nothing at all to do with this match. You know, Kazi wrestled a match under Gemini Kid's very strict scientific rules, but now Gemini has to wrestle a match of Kazi's choosing.
Well, I mean, it's Gemini's own making. He's the one that put the Weaver Cup up in the first place. You know, is he not the first person to win the Weaver Cup to put the cup on the line following the tournament?
Gemini Kid didn't even make it 1 month with the Weaver Cup, and then possibly in the most bonehead mistake of his career, he puts the Weaver Cup on the line and loses it to Kamikaze Kid.
Okay, so explain the scientific portion of sitting in a steel chair to me.
Gemini Kid is trying to prove the scientific superiority and Kazi kept his broken ankle as Gemini Kid dodged out of the way, and Kazi caught his leg in the chair.
Heads up by Gemini Kid. That could have been the match right then and there. And right now, Gemini shooting stiff right into the face. I mean, Kazi's taking a beating here early in this match, but still able to kick out on two.
You know, Gemini Kid built an entire career out of the tradition of professional wrestling, that pure basic mat scientific wrestling. But now, rather than succeeding because of that, Gemini Kid has taken the stance of almost hiding behind it.
You know, the problem I'm seeing is he keeps proclaiming how scientific he is. How is draping your opponent's throat over the top rope scientific?
And let's not forget, the only reason he won the Weaver Cup in the first place is because he put his feet on the ropes and just about broke the neck of Jesse Ortega, forcing his own pupil to tap out.
Well, I mean, it's got to be something wrong with the ego, but I tell you, there's nothing wrong with the aim of that drop kick. He caught the chair right into the knee of Kamikaze Kid. Kazi is putting himself in danger and yet not able to give it any of it back to the opponent right now.
Yeah, Kamikaze Kid is very intent on cracking the head open of the Gemini Kid. Gemini Kid is very aware of how deadly this match could be, not only as far as a win-loss record is concerned, not only as far as the Weaver Cup trophy is concerned, but as far as his own health goes.
Well, yeah, this could be a career ender for sure. We've seen Kamikaze Kid take a beating like nobody's business, the famous slide down the wall at the old dojo, and come back for more. I mean, he took a sabbatical. He's been back a few months now, and he's really turned it up a notch. I mean, look at this, flat on his stomach.
Gemini Kid had it well scouted. He knows the Kamikaze Kid can hit you from virtually any angle whatsoever. And the issue that has been building between these two individuals has led us to this Kazi's Rules match. It's pretty much winner take all. Not only do you get the Weaver Cup, but Gemini Kid at the outset of this match says if Kazi wins, he will kiss Kazi's feet.
That, you know, that's worth the price of admission alone, just to see Gemini Kid groveling at the feet of Kamikaze Kid after what he said over the past few weeks.
Hey, Kazi proved it in that match for the Weaver Cup. Kamikaze Kid, even in a scientific rules match, he had Gemini Kid's number. That match should have been completely dictated 110% by Gemini Kid, but Kamikaze Kid proved that he can hang in any match, any style.
I think a little wear and tear is starting to show around the seams of Gemini Kid. He's angry because the fans are chanting for Kazi.
Gemini Kid has almost been at a loss since that Weaver Cup Finals against Jesse Ortega, when the fans pretty much turned their back on Gemini Kid because he would rather run and hide outside the ring. And Kazi's not running and hiding. He's running and looking for another object. Oh, and he's got an old friend in the form of a steel ladder.
Oh my goodness, we're going to see a ladder inside the ring. And folks, this is legal in Kazi rules. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, about anything can go here. And look at this, Kazi going to suplex him. Oh my goodness, going to set him up. Here we go. He's going up.
Kamikaze Kid positioning Gemini Kid and now positioning the ladder, and Kazi lives and dies by the top rope, but tonight it may be by the ladder.
Oh my goodness, Gemini's up. He's got him by the pants, slings him off into the center of the ring.
Kazi crashes from atop that ladder as Gemini Kid still had enough presence of mind to avoid Kazi's onslaught. And now look at this, Gemini Kid getting rid of another object that Kazi has brought into the ring. Gemini Kid refuses to use any of these objects, much to the dismay of these fans.
Well, I mean, it's probably a good thing for Kamikaze Kid at this point, but he looks like he is on the wrong end of this beating. Now look, here we go. Beautiful back Russian leg sweep by Gemini, floats over. Beautiful scientific move. Is this not the second one of the match now?
I was going to say, I think Gemini's fighting for his King Cobra there that he's illegally made Jesse Ortega tap out to in the past. Kazi blocked it, and Gemini Kid getting very frustrated, pounding the back of the head of Kazi into the canvas.
Referee's got his eyes open. He's down for the count. 1-2, and Kazi's able to squirm his way out of that one again, just barely.
Oh, driving the knees right into the sternum there. Positioning Kazi, but no one holding the elbow drop.
Look at this, Kazi back out on the floor looking for something to hit him with. He's going for the ladder again. Here comes the ladder back into the ring. You got to wonder. This has backfired on you every time you've done this, Kazi. What are you thinking?
And Kazi has hurt himself in numerous occasions in this contest because he is so determined to destroy the Gemini Kid, and he just ran that ladder straight into the ribs of Gemini.
Gemini Kid is wanting no part of this ladder, but right now Kamikaze Kid's got control. It's like setting him up for a German.
Well, you talk about a career ender. The Kamikaze Kid can German the 20-year veteran into that ladder, but Gemini's reversed it, trying to flee Kazi, and both men jockeying for position because this could be the huge momentum changer in this contest. Kazi off the ropes and ran straight into the boot of the Gemini Kid. Gemini now hooking the arms of Kazi. Has him. Kazi trying to fight it.
My goodness, got a butterfly suplex onto the steel ladder.
Kamikaze Kid's body crashes on top of the steel ladder, bounces right off of it.
Now, he took the impact of his body weight against the ladder, the impact of the ladder springing back up from the ropes. This could be a chiropractor's dream right now. I don't know if Kazi's going to be able to continue.
Both the chair and the ladder have backfired on numerous occasions for Kazi.
Oh, God, he's got it across the throat.
Gemini Kid trying to choke Kazi out. Gemini Kid walking up the ladder while it's on the throat of Kazi.
Good gracious, look at this. Your Weaver Cup champion posing on top of the ladder draped across the throat of a man.
How disrespectful. One of the most revered individuals in the entire history of this promotion being choked by a ladder with a man standing on top of it. And Gemini Kid, how happy is he of himself?
I mean, he looks pretty satisfied right now, even though he's still shooting eyes at the crowd for not cheering him. I mean, this used to be one of the most beloved characters we'd ever known here in the Mid-Atlantic area, and obviously he's turned his back on everybody.
Has Kazi hooked now? Both arms hooked. Kazi, what is Gemini? Oh, God! What a spike DDT! As Kazi had no way whatsoever to protect himself, and Gemini Kid drove Kazi's entire body weight down on top of his skull.
Yeah, the referee's acting, asking Kazi if he wants to continue, and I'm not sure he's getting an answer at this point.
You can't ever tell with that mask on if Kazi is conscious or not. He's certainly lying immobile now. Gemini Kid, for the first time in this one, is going to the floor himself and pulling out a table.
What is he thinking? I mean, this is not Gemini Kid's forte, but yeah, so far everything has worked, you know, in his favor against Kazi.
Well, it's not every day at CWF Mid-Atlantic that you see tables, ladders, and chairs, dare I say. We don't do pointless, hardcore-style matches. The feud has to reach a certain point, and the rivalry between the Gemini Kid and the Kamikaze Kid has certainly escalated to that level.
Look of satisfaction on the face of Gemini Kid. Just, you know, he's got it worked out. You know he's thought about this. Now, here we go. He's going to sling Kazi out onto the table here, but you know, staying both men still up on the apron.
Gemini Kid has either Kazi positioned for either a power driver or a power bomb, and Kazi trying to fight his way free of it. Finally, he's able to fight his way. Gemini Kid falls to the floor with the CSA, and Kazi stops right on the back of Gemini.
Talk about a measure of payback. Gemini took this one out to the floor. Kazi followed him out, full body weight right across the kidneys. And look at this. Now Kazi's positioning Gemini on the table.
By no understatement would it have been a disaster if Gemini Kid had hit whatever he had in mind on Kazi. And now Kazi has Gemini leg on the table. Kazi a little worse for wear, but trying to work his way around. Possibly Kazi is going, possibly going up to the top rope, and Gemini Kid like thrown on that table.
You know what's on the mind of Kamikaze Kid. He wants to get airborne, and he is about ready for liftoff. Wait a minute. Gemini Kid's able to roll off the table and leave the area.
Well, Kazi avoided disaster, and you better believe Gemini Kid just did the exact same thing by getting off that table and heading to the other side of the ring.
Yeah, Gemini Kid holding his chest there. He's still feeling the effects of the boots of Kamikaze Kid through his rib cage there. Now Kazi's falling back into the ring. No, wait a minute. He's going to go back around the outside.
Certainly been a war of attrition, to say the very least, between Gemini Kid and Kazi. Oh! Kazi charged full steam ahead with the chair. Gemini kicking. And if I saw that right, I believe the end of that chair caught Kazi right in the jaw. And that could break a man's jaw in
there's a little something else for the psyche to be worked on right here. Choking him full body weight, pulling with the force of the ropes right across the throat. You know, Gemini, it's turned vicious on us here, and the throat is his target area.
Oh, Kazi caught him coming in, right in the midsection with that chair. Gemini now jumping over. Kazi, chair straight to the skull of Gemini.
That one ring like a bell across the Carolina Sports Arena. Gemini is face down. Kazi's coming after him. I believe Kazi is a bit upset.
Kazi has not had enough positioning Gemini Kid back to the corner. I don't know what in the world Kazi has in mind here. He does so many innovative things each and every match. And what in the world did Kazi have in plan for this match where there's not even any rules?
Here we go up on the, oh, both knees right into the chest. Gemini Kid with an assist from the steel chair. And Gemini Kid hunched over in the ring. He's having a hard time breathing. Now Kazi positioning the chair and the ropes.
Kazi trying to get that chair, but how many times have we seen this backfire on someone? Oh, Gemini driving the knee into Kazi. Kazi take a baseball slide and stop himself.
Ooh, Gemini kick. His skull straight into the steel chair, down to the concrete.
You ever heard a train colliding with an immobile car?
Tell you what, referee not sure what to do at this point. I mean, if Gemini Kid can't answer the 10 count, is this one over?
Well, by what I've been told, this match has to end in either a pinfall or a submission, although I guess it could be up to referee's discretion to stop the match and award the contest to either man. And right now, Gemini Kid is down and out on the floor of the CSA, peering into his Weaver Cup trophy.
Yeah, just barely. I'm not sure. Oh, wait a minute. Business picking up now. Kamikaze Kid's got hold of the face, going back into the back, working on the upper torso of Gemini Kid, front and back. Slings him back into the ring, and wait a minute, he's going up under the ring again.
Well, Kazi made sure Gemini got a very good look at the trophy that used to be his, although Kazi is now Weaver Cup champion 2006.5, I think is what he said.
Yeah, and look at this. Kazi has something in mind. He's looking for something particular under this loaded ring.
Wait, he's pulled out a bag. And with the way this crowd just responded, I think we can all take a pretty good guess at what the contents of that bag may be. But Gemini Kid just caught him with a kick.
Kazi did not see that coming. He was snapping backwards. Bag falls on the ground. You know Gemini's got to see it by now, but he's going straight back to the face of Kamikaze Kid.
That bag laying very precariously there on the mat. Gemini Kid has Kazi set upon the middle rope there, straddled it very gingerly, and what it, oh my God, if that, if the contents of that bag are what I think it is, this could, oh. Kazi thankfully blocked it and switched the leg to Gemini, who straddles the middle rope.
Kazi up in the second rope. The contents of the bag across the skull of Gemini Kid. He is screaming.
The adjectives are just not there to describe what Gemini Kid, I think, wanted to do to the lower region of Kazi and the contents of that bag, which are now officially revealed.
Oh, my goodness. Thumbtacks. Razor-sharp thumbtacks. This is not going to be good for Gemini Kid. He was watching the bag. Kazi caught him. Now, here we go. He's going to try to deposit Gemini Kid into the thumbtack.
Kamikaze Kid certainly sent fair warning to Gemini Kid that he was going to try to employ thumbtacks to this contest. He's going down. Oh, my God. I thought Gemini Kid was about to backdrop Kazi on top of him. Now, Kazi fighting for a power driver, a power bomb on top of the fence. Gemini Kid marching again. Now, Gemini going for a suplex. No. Kazi lands on his feet. Spins Gemini around.
Oh, my goodness. Gemini leaps over, if you can call that a leap, over the contents of the bag. Now he's hanging in the corner, and Kamikaze's going to the top rope.
Gemini Kid fighting for his dear life, trying to hang on to the rope. Oh, and he shoves Kazi out. Oh, Kazi's head just smacked across the floor of the CSA.
Sounded like a cantaloupe hitting the floor at the Fresh Market. Kamikaze, he's still alive. He's holding the head. We don't know his condition. We can't see through the mask. And you gotta wonder, The wheels are spinning in Gemini's kid's head right now. It looks like he's coming down to the concrete.
You can just see the desperation that was etched across the face of Gemini Kid during that entire sequence. And even though you cannot see Kazi's face, you can tell that by his body language, he knew his match and his career was in very dire straits as well.
That's right, Gemini Kid got the upper hand in this one again. Throws a few shots at Kazi. Kazi's rolling back into the ring very close to these thumbtacks that he put in the ring. I mean, is this another big backfire?
Kazi has tried to use every object to his advantage to somehow... Oh! Oh my! Gemini Kid with the thumbtack trying to pierce it through the mask of Kazi right into his eye! I think Gemini Kid has officially, with that one singular maneuver, told us everything we need to know about what kind of person he has become this year.
Yeah, good old Gemini Kid, 1,000% crapo.
Has him in a surfboard, like maneuver now, trying to stretch the arms and torso of Kamikaze Kid. Gemini Kid looking around and has spotted the thumbtacks beside of him. Oh no, Kazi, get out of this! Kazi, don't let him!
Into the thumbtacks. He's got thumbtacks hanging out of him everywhere.
The screams of Kamikaze Kid echoing through the CSA. Referee Brandon Barber screaming at Kazi to please give it up. Kazi, full chest, the hundreds of thumbtacks poking out of his hands, out of his chest, out of his head.
Pulling thumbtacks out of his fingers at this point. I mean, how do you let this continue in the first place? This is madness.
How many matches did we see Kamikaze Kid come back from what appeared to be apparent death to somehow survive? But never before have we seen hundreds of thumbtacks and holes of blood beginning to spurt out of the chest of a human being.
I tell you what, the referee asking him once again if he wants to end this. Kazi's not answering, but he's not giving up either. I think he's in shock here.
Look at the hundreds of holes that have embodied the chest of Kazi.
Gemini Kid, yeah, this is enough to make you want to throw up. Gemini Kid, the last person a year ago you would ever believe to be involved in something like this, much less showing what he's made of now, gloating on the top rope.
And mentally, what kind of state of mind can Kazi even be in? I mean, this could be something that really almost sends you off the deep end.
The referee is still pleading with him. Gemini thinks it's over. He doesn't think Kazi's going to make his way back inside the ring. And right now, I'm not so sure he can make it back in the ring if he wanted to. This is ugly.
Oh, I will certainly not frown upon Brandon Barber calling for the bell right now, ending this one and handing it to Gemini Kid. He's certainly proven his point, the mask of Kazi.
Just imagine, I mean, you see what it's done to his chest. You know, his face has got about as many thumbtacks in it as his chest did. This is not for the slight of heart. Look at this. Gemini has armed himself with a steel chair again. Mr. Scientific.
He's waiting on Kazi to re-enter the ring. So I assume Gemini can end this one once and for all.
Gemini trying to talk Kamikaze Kid. I mean, I don't know how Kazi was able to climb back in the ring in the first place. I don't know why the referee's allowing this to continue. Gemini rushes in. Kick to the knee.
Kid took the knee out of Gemini Kid, who came awfully close to impaling himself on that steel chair.
I tell you what, he's between a steel chair and thumbtacks. Gemini Kid rethinking it again, but I still don't understand how the referee is allowing this to continue.
Look at the madness invoking the body of Kazi, who charges, dives, both men crashing down upon the table.
Out of nowhere, I don't know where Kazi's getting his second win from, but you know what he's thinking. Here he goes, he's looking for, he's going to the far corner, and he's going up.
Oh, he's got Gemini Kid, but this is a horrible angle. The table's right upside the ring. If Kazi dives, here he goes.
Oh my God, the table breaks, both men crashing to the concrete.
Kamikaze Kid put his own body, he put everything on the line to try and take out the Gemini Kid. People here at the CSA on their feet. Kamikaze Kid, blood pouring out of his chest. God only knows what's going on behind the mask of that incredible young athlete as he rolls the Gemini Kid, who's pretty much dead to the wind, back inside the ring and repositioning Gemini Kid once again.
What have we said since the beginning? It's always on his mind. He wants air. He signals to the crowd. The crowd signals back. He's got to get up and get this done if he thinks he's going to win it this way.
Kazi can feel it. These people can feel it. The electricity's incredible. Double pop, frog splash. Crush is coming again. We've got a cover. Kamikaze Kid in a miraculous effort. Certainly one of the greatest efforts in the entire history of CWF Mid-Atlantic. Pins the Gemini Kid and Kazi's rules.
One of the most impressive bouts that I have ever seen in person in my life. Kamikaze Kid defeats Gemini Kid, continues to be the holder of the Weaver Cup here, brought back into the ring by referee Brandon Barber, presenting it back to Kamikaze.
I don't think there's any question that Kazi won that match on sheer willpower. His throat was crushed by a ladder. His jaw could easily be broken. He was impaled upon thumbtacks, chest first, that spike DDT. You could just go on and on. But in the end, Kazi flew possibly his greatest flight ever from the top rope to the floor of the CSA, destroyed the table, but more importantly, destroyed the body of the Gemini Kid, and Kazi will lead the CSA victorious in one of the most incredible matches we've ever seen, as Gemini Kid can do nothing but stare upon a trophy that once had his name on it.
What an incredible image. Kamikaze Kid standing between Gemini Kid and the trophy he won just a few months back.
Even our official, Brandon Barber, is
asking to kiss the foot.
That's right, he does. Some fans here still giving a standing ovation to Kazi for this effort. And Gemini Kid, now with his wits about him, is coming to the realization of his words pre-match that not only has he now been pinned, but he's going to have to suffer the ultimate in humiliation by kissing the feet of Kazi.
Tell you what, this is long overdue. I'm going to really enjoy this. I hope everybody at home's enjoying this as much as we are here in Burlington. And you know, this is history. You're seeing history being made.
He stole the Weaver Cup trophy in the finals against Jesse Ortega, and tonight Kazi has undone all the wrongs in one night and has given us the pleasure of witnessing the humiliation of the Gemini Kid. Randolph, how sweet it is. No! No! Low blow! My Gemini Kid, how dare you!
This isn't good. This match is over.
No, dear God, no!
Back first, into the thumbtacks. Gemini Kid, like a thief in the night, grabs the Weaver Cup, and off he goes. Kazi up here. Oh, come on.
How dare you, Gemini Kid? How dare you? You were not only defeated, you were convincingly defeated in one of the most premier matches in this company's history, and you steal a Weaver Cup trophy? Possession may be 9/10 of the law, but Kamikaze Kid proved he is 100 times more of a man than you are here tonight.
Got back. His tag team partner Jesse Ortega's out with a couple more officials. Oh my goodness. Commissioner Cross is out. Check on the condition of Kazi. You can tell by the backs of his arms, what is his back going to look like?
It may take.
Oh God.
It may take Kazi months to recover physically from this contest, possibly years to recover mentally.
But I never recovered.
But despite the actions of the Gemini Kid post-match, which are beyond description, Kazi can always say if this night he was the better man.
That's right, Kamikaze Kid, all you fans that support Kamikaze Kid, you wanted all that crazy stuff, you wanted the ladders, you wanted the chairs, you wanted the tables, and by God, I gave you those thumbtacks, didn't I, Kamikaze? You're still pulling them out of your head, out of your back, and out of your chest! The Gemini Kid's pretty banged up right now. Don't think I'm gonna make the Rumble tonight, but I got what I wanted. I got my Weaver cut back. That's all that matters to me anyway. That's all that matters to me, the Weaver Cup.
First of all, let me congratulate you on a tremendous win. That was awesome.
Sheik.
I know you're banged up.
I'm banged up tonight. I'm not even going to make the Rumble tonight. I'm hurt.
Yeah, I heard about that.
I got the trophy.
That's a shame. But by the way, since you're not going to be able to make the Rumble tonight, I know you've had a past history of drawing a pretty good number.
Yeah, I drew 30 tonight.
Well, you know what? Just great, because since you're not able to make tonight, I'd like to make you an offer you can't refuse and perhaps purchase that number 30.
You said I couldn't. I'm wrestling tonight. I'm fine. Number 30. I'm fine. How much you owe me? Huh. Oh, you know, when I went through that table, that really hurt. Lumpy, if you want 30, 13, no, whatever number I said, 30. My head's really spinning.
I think it was 30.
Spinning right
said
now.
30, right?
You just make sure those 30. Zeros are right on that check. You
got number 30. Don't worry about the check.
You got number
check's
30.
Check's in now. The mail. Appreciate it.
You got number 30.
Congratulations once again. Great win.
Hey, you got a couple of extras? Because I hear those masseuses down at the beach, they work
whatever
a little
you want.
Tonight is another chapter in one of the most heated rivalries of the year. One side represents all that is good in professional wrestling today, upholding the tradition of years long since past and carrying that very torch well into the 21st century. He's our Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight Champion, the Boogie Woogie Man, Rob McBride. He has had a career year in 2006, becoming the first man in history to have ever won the Mid-Atlantic Triple Crown. And tonight, Rob McBride not only looks to continue his own legacy, but the legacy handed down by the legend, the original Boogie Woogie Man, Jimmy Valiant himself. Standing across the ring from McBride tonight is his polar opposite, caring nothing for the past and rich tradition of this sport. Joey Sylvia will once again embark on a quest that has eluded him for a lifetime. 6 years of Rumbles and championship matches in CWF have come and gone for Joey Sylvia, and all have had the same result. They have ended in complete failure. With unlimited athletic ability, Sylvia has never been able to conquer his greatest demon, his all-encompassing ego. Now aligning himself alongside the new dynasty, can Sylvia put all the past failures behind him and win not just the first title of his CWF career, but the Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight title itself? Or will tradition continue to live and breathe through one of its proudest champions ever? It's McBride versus Sylvia, Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight title.
Hey!
go one step further until I make another announcement.
What?
I'm tired of you and the other New Dynasty members running roughshod, doing whatever you want. So Steve Green, Scuba Steve, Simply Steve, whatever you hit the back. You're not going to be out of here. You are not a manager. Therefore, you are not a ringside. Hank Lawson, buddy, I know where your heart's at. But you're not a manager either. Unfortunately, you can't be a ringside either. But Steve Green, I'm tired of it. Hit the bricks. Get out of here. This match.
Whoa, 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 Commissioner Ross, that's for your own. You see, I came to Burlington for one reason, that's for this tonight. Because these stupid redneck people out here, they all know they want to cheat tonight.
Gary Coleman.
Don't start that chant. Oh, you shut up! They can start that chant all they want. The reason why I'm here tonight, Commissioner Ross, is this.
Jim.
I do now.
I like this. This is good. This is good.
And since you don't provide an unsafe workplace, I talked to Dale Gagne. You know what he told me? That I can hire my own security. So right now, I'm going to bring up my head of security, Simply Steve Green.
Wow! I'm back!
So now from now on.
Oh, yeah! I love it!
It's all evil. So Commissioner Morris, you get this song out of here.
Are you telling me he's your manager from now on?
Of course!
This ain't no one night thing, right?
No, all the time, yeah. Contract signed.
You got a contract?
I got a contract, it's signed.
Signed, sealed, delivered.
Nothing you can do about it, Cross.
Show it to you, Cross.
Oh, yeah.
You know, Joey,
I love it.
I knew you had something up your sleeve, Danny. I know. You know, you can have your fantasy guys from the 80s movies. You know, you got Gary Coleman and Karate Kid.
One of the highest feuds of 2006 is rekindled once again. Mid-Atlantic heavyweight title on the line. Joey Sylvia having his blows shrugged off in the early going by our champion, Mid-Atlantic heavyweight champion, the boogie-woogie man, Rob McBride.
Rob McBride, he's not one to back down even with the numbers against him on the outside. We've been seeing all this whole thing about the manager's license and protection from the crowd. I mean, if your manager is afraid of the crowd, why don't he stay in the dressing room?
Exactly. Commissioner Cross, God bless him. He tried to do the right thing and get these jokers ejected from ringside. No Steve Green, no Ty Dillinger, not even Tank Lawson. Tried to make this a fair one-on-one contest, because how many times in the past have we seen the New Dynasty try and rob one, steal one from Rob McBride? Because Ty Dillinger pulled the trump card out, and him and Steve Green are allowed to stay at ringside, which Randolph, honestly, quite honestly, scares me a little bit.
Well, you know, you're still talking about Joey Sylvia, the man who has blown every chance in the world to ever win a major title. I mean, that's sort of been a punchline for months.
And you actually got that one off before me, because there's nothing I like talking more about than Joey Sylvia being the biggest choke artist in the entire history of CWF Mid-Atlantic. Sylvia's been around since virtually day one, and here we are all these years later. No championships, no Rumble, no Weaver Cup, no nothing. Sylvia has never won a major prize. He's failed in every attempt ever, and God willing, it'll happen here again tonight.
Kind of wonder right now, he's trying to work on the arm of the Boogeyman. The Boogeyman doesn't seem to be much affected. Finally taking off his feet by a neat little trip.
Sylvia, taking nothing away from him, is an incredible wrestler. I mean, possibly one of the greatest pure athletes that we've ever seen. It's just that his ego and his friends frequently get in the way of his success.
I'll tell you what, right now, the canvas is getting in the way of his success. He just got dropped on it by the Boogeyman, who swatted him off like a fly.
Of course, these were the last two individuals in the Battle Royal that led us to fill the vacated Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight title that, of course, was vacated when Rick Converse won the AWA World Heavyweight title. And when Sylvia lost that match to Rob McBride, I think that burned, that ate away at him more than any loss he's ever had. Sylvia will just not let it go. Sylvia is determined to somehow take home that Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight title, but he just keeps failing and failing and failing.
Yeah, and I tell you what, right now, the Boogeyman looks to be having a little bit of fun with him. It looked like a thumb jabbed into the throat there behind the referee's back, and McBride's just having a ball here. Oh, wedgie.
Wow.
We don't call that very often.
Of course, this series of bouts, although Rob McBride is making it look very one-sided at this point, has certainly not been so. In fact, Sylvia holds a singles victory over Rob McBride in the Weaver Cup in a tremendous contest that I think ranks right up there with some of the best matches of 2006.
You know how hard it was for me not to make a turn the other cheek joke right now like this. Sylvia to the eyes of the champion, a boot to the midsection here, and he's got Boogeyman reeling backwards here. Sylvia showing his first offensive burst, knee.
Yeah, but how often do we see one guy really on a roll, has some great momentum, and then a stupid eye rake or poke to the eye will halt it immediately? We need to establish some kind of warning system for eye rakes, Randolph.
We just let the wrestlers wear protective eyewear. Maybe that would be the solution here. They can all wear goggles.
I was going to say, I had this vision of Rob McBride running around like LeDamon and Tomlinson's visor there on the football field.
Well, that's an idea, but I mean, imagine what headbutts do to you if you're wearing something like that. But, you know, that's the good thing about wrestling. It's man on man here, and this one man, Joey Sylvia, just landed flat on his back from low Earth orbit, it looked like.
That was a phenomenal backdrop, to say the very least. Now, Rob McBride, once again, things in hand, hammered away on the skull of Joey Sylvia.
Yeah, he looks to be just playing with him. I'm thinking at this point, Rob could probably put this guy away.
Big old school atomic drop. How often do you see those anymore, Randolph?
You know, the fans appreciate it here. Now look at this.
Oh, Sylvia ducked down, and Rob McBride just clotheslined himself on the top rope.
I tell you what, Sylvia taking advantage. He's going to toss the champion out to the floor. And you know what that means? And what do we say? Just like a pack of mad dogs, simply Steve Green simply goes berserk on the outside of the ring.
This was exactly the situation Commissioner Cross wanted to avoid by kicking these goons out of here.
Tell you what, Boogeyman not in a good position. Sylvia positioned herself on the apron.
Sylvia back first on the floor of the CSA. What a smack!
You got to wonder, how smart was that in a title match? I mean, he got nothing but concrete.
Both Ty Dillinger and Steve Green trying to make sure Joey Sylvia is even still breathing, because believe me, Rob McBride could be winning this match on a countout right now if not for the goons that are probably going to help Sylvia get back to his feet.
Well, look at this. McBride's going to come in and have a little something for Mr. Simply here. Simply burn his chest up, pick him up, and toss him on Sylvia.
Oh, the new dynasty are not having a good night so far.
I tell you what, they've got to be rethinking this whole situation. Boogie climbs back into the ring. So, I mean, they're really counting on Sylvia now.
Rob
McBride. Oh, wait.
Oh no, Rob, no! No, think better of it, Rob! Rob McBride crushes the New Dynasty, possibly a very ill-advised maneuver by the Boogie Woogie Man, but Rob McBride loves to channel the spirit of some of his old friends.
Yeah, right there, we heard the bang bang just really loud there, and it was like a shootout because we've got bodies everywhere down here on the floor.
Well, I would certainly hate to see a Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight title match ending in a double countout. God knows we haven't had that in years here at CWF Mid-Atlantic.
I'll tell you what, Boogie's trying to get back up on his feet. I mean, everything he's feeling right now is self-inflicted. Right off that apron itself, he had the choice. He could have rolled in and let the referee count. This match would have been over.
Steve Green still running interference, and even though he may be getting the worst of it from Rob McBride, he's still at least providing that momentary distraction, which gives Joey Sylvia that extra second to revive himself, and that extra second may have just saved him on that kickout.
That right there, I'm not sure Sylvia knew what the count was, but he heard the count, and he made the jump. I mean, he's just now coming back to conscious. Jawbreaker.
Driving the bottom jaw of Rob McBride into the top of the skull, you sacrifice yourself to try and hurt your fellow opponent. And now Sylvia, now you don't want to get into a chop fest with Rob McBride and Sylvia full steam ahead.
Finally showing a little bit of smarts here. He's got the champion backed up to the corner and now brings him out, flips him over, and you got to wonder, here we go, kick to the middle of the back.
This is where Sylvia thrives a lot. From up top, leg drop, right across the larynx. Here's the cover, Red Jones, the count, Rob McBride.
Only a two count, Sylvia, not happy with it, but he's not arguing. He's going back to work on the champion. Smart move on his part, as much as I hate to say it.
Well, he's trying to tie Rob McBride up. He's got that arm grapevine with the legs. He could have a cross face like submission. Oh, I can't really tell from this angle, but referee Red Jones right in there checking, saying Rob McBride's not about to give this one up.
Right, face down, getting stretched apart right here by the challenger right now. Sylvia showing out. You know, this is the first time he's really been able to turn this match around in his favor without the help of any goons on the outside.
Steve Green peering in there. You know, him and Ty Dillinger are going to be right there if Joey Sylvia gets into any kind of trouble at all. We've already seen in this one. And now Sylvia grinding away on the face of Brock.
Yeah, he got him over close to the ropes, and he rolled him over a little bit to make him a little bit easier accessible for his friends on the outside, I'm sure. But referee Red Jones right there in the right positioning so they could not get involved.
Of course, Rob McBride's been on a very arduous schedule as of late. He's not only our Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight Champion, he's also one half of the Tag Team Champions along with Tank Lawson. And it was only last month we saw Rob McBride, because he's such a fighting champion, make up for a full month's worth of title defenses in one match, in a four quarters match. That's the great thing about having Rob McBride as our champion. If Rob McBride doesn't feel that he's given the fans their money's worth, Rob McBride is going to make up for it.
Well, that's always been his history. Right now, he just took both boots to the face, able to kick out on a two after that one. Sylvia's starting to show us some serious opposition for the champion here at this point, but he's not able to put him away yet.
Joey Sylvia certainly oversized and in many ways outmatched against Rob McBride, who's certainly the veteran of this matchup. But when you have these idiots at ringside running so much interference, you're probably going to win more matches than you lose.
That's right. You got to wonder. I mean, this whole idea of the addition of Ty Dillinger to the New Dynasty, I mean, they were dangerous enough without another small mind to guide them.
Green just put Rob McBride's face into a table. The referee needs to quit getting distracted by Sylvia and pay attention to Steve Green smashing McBride's face into a table at ringside.
McBride has got to be seeing a lot of little stars and little birdies flying around his head. Sylvia taking advantage up to the second rope. Drops a hammer down across the face. Goes for the cover. One, two. Boogie's able to kick out just barely on that one.
Well, he's feeling it from his peoples right now. They are 110% behind the Boogie Woogie Man. And Sylvia, can you feel the failure starting to sneak in a little bit there?
Yeah, we're starting to see a little bit of a repeat from previous past histories. Right now, Sylvia's got the legs grapevine, asking Boogie if he wants to quit. There's no quit in this guy.
Boy, when You can see when that frustration starts to set in on Joey Sylvia. He can feel those demons from the past starting to creep up. Tell him, oh, you can't do it. You're going to fail again. And that's why he starts the facial on Sylvia. He wants it so very, very bad. But Rob McBride wants it just as much. And like Rob McBride told us all earlier, they will have to kill him to retake away the Mid-Atlantic heavyweight title.
Right now, this is the closest I have seen in a long time anybody putting the boogeyman down. He's done had the arm drop twice. If it drops third time, we've got a new champion. Wait a minute, the leg kicks up.
Sylvia cannot believe it, screaming no, but Rob McBride is screaming yes. Ty Dillinger having an absolute coronary at ringside.
Dillinger thought this one was over, but it's going to continue. Boogie able to show that he's still got life inside that body. Sylvia doing everything he can to remove it.
Sylvia, are you kidding me? Going for Northern Lights! Collapses with McBride on top, both men down. What in the world was Sylvia thinking trying to Northern Lights Rob McBride?
Sylvia must have been listening to that little guy in the suit on the outside, because I don't think he would have thought of that one on his own.
He may have been able to Northern Lights Ty Dillinger, Gary Coleman out there, but he sure ain't going to Northern Lights Rob McBride.
He might have been able to Northern Lights referee Red Jones, but yeah, Rob McBride, I don't see that happening.
Oh, Rob McBride's back on his feet. Big chop across the chest to Sylvia.
And look at that. Lit up the chest. Lit it up again. Did you hear that?
It echoes throughout the CSA. And Sylvia has been a fight he doesn't want any part of.
Right now, Sylvia face first into the top turnbuckle. The champion's going to start taking him apart.
Rob McBride is about to prove why. Oh, Rob McBride thought he was going for a German there, but no. Back suplex. Sylvia, somehow, thanks to incredible athletic ability, lands on his feet and ends in gurry right upside the cranium of McBride.
McBride is down. Sylvia trying to struggle back up. And neither one of these men are faring very well after the beating each of them has dished out. Sylvia, the first back up to a slightly vertical position, finally back to his feet. Drags McBride up with him. Now he's trying to put him back down with closed fists.
It's back and forth right now. You got to think possibly the next big maneuver hit could spell the end for one of these individuals. Sylvia now going up top, possibly. Moonsault, no. McBride from behind. Sylvia crashed chest first into that table that Steve Green had brought over. If Sylvia did not break something, it'll be a miracle.
Sylvia may be out. This one may be over. Referee needs to make the count right here. We can't really tell from this angle, but I mean, I'm not even sure he's conscious at this point.
That was as nasty of a fall as I may have ever seen in this building. Double noggin knocker for Gary Coleman and the American Steel Ninja, or whatever their names are.
That's right, look at this. Sylvia's back up, but he's only up because McBride picked him up. He's going to sling him back into the ring and get this one over with in the right fashion.
I don't know how Sylvia's even going to catch his breath after that horrible fall on the outside, but somehow he's kicking out.
See what, McBride looks a little stunned there. He's calling for a little help from the peoples. And look at this. McBride's going up, and here we go. Ty Dillinger on the outside. Steve Green able to deliver a shot to the skull, and it's with a steel chain.
Ty Dillinger has the official, and Steve Green had used that chain. Rob McBride laying unconscious. Sylvia flies, crushing McBride. Oh, no red. Red. No, don't get it. Two. Rob McBride is still alive!
Sylvia, perhaps stunned most of all, as McBride's able to kick out. We don't know where it comes from. I mean, this is all, according to him, due to you, the people.
Sylvia had the match won, but because of McBride, because of people, like you said, the failure is starting to swoop the body of Joey Sylvia. One more time, McBride, reversal, Sylvia, and the Steve Green. McBride has him up. Saturday night, superstar, and God bless it, Ty Dillinger has Red Jones again.
What are you talking about, Willis? Red, get down here and count this match. Let's end this thing.
Rob McBride, oh, Red, two. Sylvia kicked out! Incredible! I'm at a loss for words!
Joey Sylvia kicked out of the Saturday Night Superstar.
And I tell you what, he's crawling over to his partner on the outside. Did they slip him something? I mean, the referee wouldn't know. He's too busy having a conversation with a former child star.
Will someone please get Ty Dillinger out of here?
Tell you what, Joey Sylvia trying to make his way back up to the... Wait a minute. Oh my goodness, big fist straight to the face again!
Yeah, but Joey Sylvia has that chain that Steve Green handed him! Now we're on the throat of McBride! Neckbreaker with the chain! He's got it wrapped right around the throat! Oh! He's got that chain concealed by the forearm! Referee Red Jones is over there checking! He's checking the arm of McBride! If it jumps one more time, Sylvia's won the title! No! Sylvia has not won the title!
Sylvia got a look of disbelief like I have never seen before. I mean, you know, the old thing's happening again. How many times this guy got to choke before he finally runs out of air?
McBride still has plenty of air! He's getting back to his feet! Sylvia still trying to hang on to that chain, but McBride's elbowing his way out of this predicament!
That's right, look at this, the chain. Oh, swung the chain, McBride met him, caught him again, straight to the face, chopped to the chest, and looky here, there's the chain.
McBride now has the chain! What's good for the goose is good for Joey Sylvia as well! Straight into the face!
And the chain back out on the outside. Boogeyman standing over Sylvia now. Now it looks like he's going to have a little fun at the expense of Sylvia. Sets him up for the Saturday Night Superstar.
That's our second Saturday Night Superstar. Good Lord! Red Jones is getting distracted by Todd Dillinger. There we go. Rob McBride had enough of that.
Rob McBride should have had enough of it. He's had this match won twice. But because of the little fella in the suit on the outside, referee Red Jones has not been in position. What is that smell?
McBride with Sylvia! Has Sylvia up high! Power bombs the corpse of Jolie Sylvia to the canvas, and it's over again!
He's got hold of the referee's leg, pulled him out of the ring.
Red Jones was counted three. You better believe that was a three count all day long.
Steve Green. What is that smell?
That is a horrible smell. I swear to God, I wish you people could smell what we smell. That's something he has on that rag. He's dragged across the face of Rod McBride.
McBride is down. Now look at this. Steve Green throws his unconscious buddy's arm over the midsection. And now Ty Dillinger goes, Red, go make a count.
No, Red. Stop. Don't count it. Joey Sylvia has won the Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight title.
And he won it by choking out the champion with something on a rag, and it took three of them to do it.
The smell on that rag, whatever it is, engulfed the entire Carolina Sports Arena. You can, even from where we're sitting, Randolph, you can smell it. God only knows what it was like across the face of Rob McBride. Tank Lawson in to check on the condition of his best friend, but Sylvia, Steve Green, Ty Dillinger, out of here like a shot in the night, and Joey Sylvia has indeed become the new Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight Champion.
I tell you, it's a sad day seeing a former champion laid out in the ring by something that had nothing to do with wrestling skill. But this one looks like it's going to stand. Tank Lawson looks on disbelief, and Boogie is still down.
I guess in his own mind, Joey Sylvia exercised his demons of all the years past, all those past failures, but it took Ty Dillinger, Steve Green, and some kind of chemical to leave Rob McBride unconscious. Certainly a shocking conclusion to not only the match, but the title run of one of the proudest Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight Champions of modern times, the Boogie Woogie Man, Rob McBride. And if you thought the ego of Joey Sylvia was unbearable before, what in the world is it going to be like next time we come back, Randolph?
I tell you what, I don't know, but we need to get medical attention into the ring right now. McBride is still down. He's not responding to anything.
You got that chip, he was moved to.
Oh, my God, I killed Boogie. Wake up, man, Santa.
Get it, buddy! Get it! 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 Get
sure a lot of you are concerned about how the kid is doing. After that very brutal Kazi Rules match, don't worry. I talked to Jim and I in the back, he's fine. I'm going to get right down to business. Seems like everybody's been wanting to talk tonight. I'm not going to waste too much time. I know that a lot of you people here tonight, I'm sure a small percentage, might have came out here to see Rick Don't Call Me Chuck Taylor Converse. I'm sure some of you probably came here tonight to make fun of Brad Sawyer's hairdo. And I know that most of you came here tonight because CWF was having Fan Appreciation Night.
Shut up.
You're slapping all over yourself. Shut up, old man. I got one question. Why are you sitting like this? Get out and shut up before I get out of here and knock you down. As I was saying, I know the majority of you low-life $1,000 worth of goodies just for you to buy a ticket and show up tonight.
I bet you love to have a freebie.
I brought my checkbook tonight for one reason. My intentions were to buy up the last five numbers in a rumble and hand them out to all my guys. As a matter of fact, I went ahead and bought one number already. I talked to the Gemini kid in the back. He was lucky enough to draw number 30. I have purchased his number. I am in the rumble, and I'm going to win it. As far as the other thing, as far as the other numbers go, I didn't buy them, but I had another idea. Since this fan break, what is your problem?
You!
Anyway, I had some extra money to spend tonight, and since it is Fan Appreciation Night, I'm not gonna play around with any of this $1,000 of gifts to be divvied up amongst all you. I'm gonna write a check for $5,000 for one person tonight. All you gotta do is come up here in this ring and kiss the flag of the United Arab Emirates, my financial backers. $5,000. I got my checkbook right here. Gemini Kid, he sold his number. I know there's somebody else in this building wants to make some money tonight.
Whatever you want! I'll help you, Captain!
How about you?
Whatever you want! I'll do whatever you want!
Whatever you want! You know what? $5,000 might not buy your breakfast, but I'm willing to give you a shot. You come up here and kiss this flag, I'll write you a check. Hey. tip the building over and kill all of us. You serious? You want some money? You gonna kiss this flag?
Don't do it!
Hey, go ahead and bring your stuff on in here. Bring that in here too. People might not know this, but on my checks, I got a little key on there. It's called a key account. And what that means is I can write a check for any amount, and with that little key, whoever gets that check, they don't even have, they know the money's in there. Look it up. Now then, we ain't got all night, big boy. Get on your knees, bow this flag, and kiss it. Oh, yes! Man wants to make some money tonight.
Money talks.
Now, you know what? Probably about 2 months ago, you was chasing me around the ring.
Money talks,
son. Sit down, Twizzler. Give me that flag.
Hey, why don't you
pull
that
and take that car? There you go. We'll do this the right way. Put that down there on top of that. Now, kiss it again.
Money talks!
Speaking of money, some of you might remember not too long ago I had a bodyguard named Asad Khalif. Turns out his visa was illegally obtained. He's been sent back to Iraq because for some reason, unless you're not Hispanic, you can't stay in this country illegally.
You're kicking the wrong flag, boy.
So it just so happens there, I have an opening. Wait, I have an opening for a bodyguard. Mr. Khalif's gone. You want to make some more? Don't tear up my flag now. You want some more money?
Let's shake right.
You need a bodyguard?
No.
They will give you the money first.
You sold out. You sold out. You sold out. You sold out.
Yeah. He's the only smart guy in the building.
You sold out.
Other than myself.
You sold out. You ain't gonna get no money.
Here's your fan club now, right there. Your fan club.
Money talks, y'all. Money talks. Money talks. Money talks. This stuff right here. Green talks. This talks.
Sock now.
This talks.
When is a match more than just a match? Thousands upon thousands may be viewed in a lifetime, but only a select few are forever ingrained into our hearts and minds. For 6 years, no singular match has provided as many memorable moments in the Mid-Atlantic as the CWF Rumble. From heart-stopping eliminations to incredible feats of endurance to emotional victories, every one of tonight's 30 athletes will have the opportunity to shine like never before. It's the Rumble, and everybody's got a story. In 2004, Brad Attitude was victorious. In 2005, Rick Converse survived all the odds. And now in 2006, Can-X, Cyrus, and the Dynasty make it 3-for-3 in the Rumble. Brad Stutz has led many competitors into the Rumble over the years, only to have them all end in failure or betrayal. Now 1 year removed from the most bitter of losses, his faction looks to recoup from the most shocking of defections as the sole remaining members look to bring the biggest of wins back to Fatback Enterprises. The self-proclaimed king was only here for a few short months and had victory in his grasp 1 year ago, only to have it slip away at the very last second. Now, 1 year later, can Marcellus King go that one step further and become a true king of the Mid-Atlantic? There's never been a rookie in CWF history that's undergone a trial by fire like Roy Wilkins. And tonight, the rage is set to come out on 29 other opponents. While Michael McAllister may be helpless to defend himself, Solomon Spades has led him to championship glory in the past. Can tonight be the night where the Dark Watch takes over the Mid-Atlantic? El Fuego Jesse Ortega, already a TV title run that broke records, a Weaver Cup champion, and now just a Rumble win away from adding to his already growing legacy. He's already having a career year as Mid-Atlantic television champion. Brass Monkey, one of the true veterans of the Rumble, will get another shot tonight. Brad Attitude began his career in this very match in 2002. 2 years later, he was the winner. 2 years from winning it is tonight. The Diamond is one of the most improved wrestlers in the entire Mid-Atlantic throughout 2006. Can tonight be KC McKnight's night to shine like never before? Simply Steve Green represents the new dynasty. No longer the American Steel Ninja, Simply Steve Green looks to redeem his 2005 elimination. Rock and Roll Matty D, he returns to the scene of the crime, 1 year removed from a shocking Final Four appearance that ended in disaster. A very handsome man has had it all slip away. Can Mitch Connor rebound and take home one of his biggest wins ever? 6 years of Rumbles, and as of tonight, only one person will have competed in each and every one, and that one person is not even a man. G-Star looks to make this Rumble her greatest ever. He's already the strongest man in the Mid-Atlantic. He's already a tag team champion, and he's one of the most popular wrestlers in CWF history. Tonight, can Tank Lawson make this his biggest Rumble ever? It's the one match that everyone has waited all year for, from the fans to the announcers to the wrestlers themselves. One match for that one moment, for that one memory. The Rumble is next.
2006 CWF Rumble. Rock and Roll Matty D!
I got what I wanted! Now it's time to step up! I'm not 29, I'm number one for a reason, and I'm gonna win tonight!
Come on! Come on, baby!
This is what dreams are made of right here.
I couldn't agree more, Matty D. The 6th annual CWF Rumble is about to get officially underway, and a very sportsmanlike start to it as Rock and Roll Matty D takes on Brass Monkey number 1 and number 2.
And that's the way it works out. I mean, this is all a numbers thing, numbers pulled from a hat. Matty D, though, I mean, he had a high number. He took it back to the back, held it up because he's got something to prove. He wanted to start this thing from the beginning and end it.
You know, I can understand to some degree, but Matty D, he drew number 29. I mean, it doesn't get much better than that, but without a chance to get his revenge on Michael Yamaha tonight, he decided he'd take it one step further. He would request number 1. And right now, it's Matty and Monkey may take a bite out of crime, which is normally a page out of Monkey's playbook.
Monkey's saying, wait a minute, that's my move. I think I surprised him more than anything. Look at this. And Matty's like, okay, what's good for the goose, good for the gander. These two young men, this is quite entertaining already.
This would certainly be a very fun match for the Mid-Atlantic television title.
Ow.
And of course, Whoever wins this 6th annual CWF Rumble gets a shot at any title they want. And last year, Rick Converse won. He then won the Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight title, and everyone knows the story from there. He then won the AWA World Heavyweight title. So who knows what may befall the eventual winner of this match. And our number three is one of our newcomers, Justin Duke.
Yeah, Justin Duke making his way into the ring now. See how this one turns around. These two guys in here biting on each other, working it around. Duke going to the top rope, going to try to take advantage of this.
Well, both guys were temporarily distracted with one another, but not for long enough for Justin Duke's sake.
And I tell you what, Justin Duke was interrupting a little something going on. They're both taking it out on him right now.
60 seconds of competition has quickly led to a double team on Mr. Justin Duke.
Yeah, Justin Duke interrupted these two guys, beating the fire out of each other, and I guess it got the ire up of both of them because now they're beating the fire out of him.
I think we only got a small taste, quite literally, of what could befall us in a Matty D Brass Monkey singles match. And right now, Justin Duke is getting more than he can handle. And remember, in the CWF Rumble, it's only 60 seconds between each entry.
That's right. Now, you know, it's time for number four to make his way in. And oh my goodness, Matty D's flying into Justin Duke. Number four making his way into the ring area right now.
Yeah, Mr. Popularity himself, Michael McAllister, who
joined in. Right.
Apparently he's not the teammate that Brass Monkey and Matty D requested.
That's right. And I tell you what, now they've turned their ire on to Michael McAllister, and no amount of man voice is going to save him from these two because they are fired up. Look at this. Just stop the clothesline.
Backcracker on Michael McAllister, and it couldn't happen to a better man. And what in the world is Matty D and Brass Monkey having in mind here? McAllister gets crushed.
McAllister in the wrong place at the wrong time. And I tell you right now, I think he wishes he was already eliminated here. Now, Matty D and Monkey help each other up, but you got to watch it there. They're going to jump each other again.
Well, now that they've incapacitated their two other opponents, it's time for some real wrestling. Number five, another rookie from the CWF Dojo, Cecil Scott. And this is such a huge match for any rookie that gets into it because it's an even playing field. A rookie can make the biggest match of his life his first one.
Now, tell you what, he just made the first mistake of the match. I mean, he was, you know, flailing away on Justin Duke. Brass Monkey, Matty D come over, get his attention, and he quits.
Matty D has apparently studied many, many tapes of Brass Monkey. And now Monkey's showing him how it's done as we got McAllister and Justin Duke fighting it out.
Oh, there you go. Now Monkey and Matty D making a teamwork out of this deal here. Cecil Scott, I mean, he's got to be in a world of hurt. Now he finally gets somebody one-on-one over in the corner.
Of course, it's been noted many times in the past, a man is eliminated when thrown over the top rope, both feet touch the arena floor, and we're about to have number six on their way to the ring.
Los Chivas!
Los Chivas, I believe this is numero uno, which of course would be the first one in.
Yeah, that's numero uno. I recognize that headbutt style anywhere.
The very unorthodox style, to say the least, of one of Mexico's most popular soccer teams.
That's right, nobody wants a part of it right now. You know, I mean, wait a minute, Justin Duke gonna come in. He's gonna get gored.
He got gored. He's getting gored from head to toe.
And Cecil Scott over here in the opposite corner trying to eliminate the first man from this year's Rumble. This is, the goat's not sure who to jump.
Cecil Scott gets gored in the nether region as Los Chivas has certainly thrown many a man off their game plan here in the early going of the 6th annual CWF Rumble.
Yeah, and I tell you what, we got the next one in, and oh, business is picking up. Big Donnie Dollars enters the fray.
Certainly poised to be a big heavy hitter as Fatback Enterprises, crumbling as it is, with Michael Yamaha just having his little pouty fit and leaving CWF and Fatback Enterprises. Donnie Dollars is pretty much the sole survivor left for Brad Stutz to put all his change into and try to get something back. And Dollars is in the ring going off on an old foe in Matty D.
And going off now on Los Chivas. I mean, whoever's first in line, Big Donnie Dollars, is going to go right off on. Look at that. Los Chivas attacks him low and got him down on his knees.
All right, fans, elimination
Las Chivas taking a sabbatical on Dollar's head there, but Dollar's sidesteps him, and our first elimination of the sixth annual Rumble comes at the hand of Donnie Dollar's, and Cecil Scott may have just attacked the wrong man.
Cecil Scott looking for somebody to get hooked up with here. Smartest thing to do might be lay down on the floor and hold on to the rope, but Cecil Scott is number two on the way out.
Got Ashley Walker coming to the ring next. And Justin Duke just got caught in the arm, and Justin Duke takes a very unhospitable toss to the arena floor. We've got Monkey and Donnie Dollar squared off now.
And Brass Monkey trying to initiate something. Gonna back up just a little bit, take the boot, and here we go back into the midsection. Dollars goes to rake in the face, and this would be a very interesting singles match.
It certainly would. Dollars has already eliminated three individuals in a short time in there. Clothesline, Brass Monkey in the back of the head, and that's four in less than 90 seconds for Donnie Dollars. And who is Dollars talking trash to the stands?
I don't know, but I tell you, Donnie Dollars, the rate he's going, he could be the only man left standing if he keeps taking them out the rate he's taking them out.
Matty D and Dollars square off once again. Wait a second. That's Otto Swan! Otto Swan, who Dollars has supposedly recently ended the career of. Dollars! Otto Swan is in from the crowd and is eliminating Donnie Dollars!
G-Star, you next one up. I tell you, Swan's up, making his exit. He did what he came to do.
Otto Swan's getting a little bit of retribution from Donnie Dollars, recently trying to put him out of action, and we got a tag team match right now. It's G-Star and Matty D, two-thirds of the GD range, and Michael McAllister is out of there, courtesy of G-Star.
The man boys hits the concrete. His night's over. Ashley Walker getting battered face first into the corner. He doesn't want to get up at this point.
And right now, Ashley Walker is squared off with the only individual to appear in each and every CWF Rumble, and G-Star is taking it right to his face.
I tell you what, G-Star could be a wild card in this one. The world's most dangerous woman is very capable of winning this bout.
Especially when she's alongside her regular tag team partner in Rock and Roll, Matty D. If these two can team up and eliminate one as each one comes in. Oh, but we get the powerhouse, Marcellus King in.
Marcellus King got the back of the hair from G-Star, and oh, he tastes the elbows.
Wait, you don't square off against G-Star and think she's just some average, puny little woman. G kick to the midsection of Marcellus King, trying to close on Marcellus King, absorbing it. G going for another one.
I tell you what, Marcellus King hit the ring fresh, ducks under the clothesline, goes behind, setting her up.
STO by Marcellus King on G-Star.
G-Star's down. Marcellus King partially disrobing here. Back to work on G-Star. We've still got a battle going on over here in the corner. This is going to get difficult to call as this ring fills up.
The powerful Marcellus King, the self-proclaimed king of Mid-Atlantic, depositing G-Star over the ropes, but G trying to hang on, trying to fight her way back inside the square circle. Oh, Marcellus drops down, close like G across the top rope, and G has been eliminated from the sixth annual Rumble.
That's right. Look at this. Ashley Walker holding up Rock and Roll Matty D. And here we got another one of the monsters of the dojo making his way in. Matty D taking a beating inside. Big Ray Kendrick finally making his entrance into the run.
Yes, Ray Kendrick making his first ever CWF match is poised to be one of the prize pupils from the CWF Mid-Atlantic Dojo. Well, we got some size in there right now with Ray and Marcellus King.
That's right. And I tell you what, Ashley Walker's taking a beating right now. Matty D's trying to get away from Marcellus King. King trying to work him over. Now, this is getting pretty good. This is why we do this every year, people.
Ashley Walker, of course, recently the personal assistant of Mr. Champagne himself. That relationship, I don't know, it's kind of on the mend or on the break, depending on your point of view right now. And we gotta make note, because of what happened earlier in the night, neither the Gemini Kid or the Kamikaze Kid is gonna be able to compete in this year's edition of the Rumble. I'm not sure who's taking Kazi's place, but we did see the Gemini Kid sold his number, and we all know that Gemini Kid's always had the greatest luck in CWF history when it comes to drawing numbers in the Rumble. He sold number 30 to none other than Sheik Cornelius J. Lumpkin III.
Yeah, beautiful. Puts him in the cat bird position, coming in last. when most of the guys involved in this match will already be eliminated. I mean, they're battling in here right now, and it's tooth and nail. We've got Ashley Walker trying to get forced over the top rope. Is this Jerry Wayne and Ray Kandrak?
Yeah, Jerry, yeah, you're exactly right. That's Jerry Wayne trying to lend Ray Kandrak a helping hand and get rid of Ashley Walker, who's hanging on to that top rope like his life depended on it. Meanwhile, Matty D in a world of hurt squared off with Marcellus King.
Marcellus King showing off the power as he does frequently. Did you see the countdown clock in the left-hand corner here? Our next man makes his entrance here. Oh, next competitor. Oh, it's Los Chivas Numero Dos.
Well, his tag team partner may no longer be there, but it's time to go again, courtesy of Los Chivas Numero Dos.
I tell you what, Los Chivas doesn't even have his wrestling boots on. He's going on a cheval tonight.
Marcellus King and Ray Kandrak squared off. Certainly the biggest challenge that either man has faced so far in this Rumble. Marcellus King now off the ropes. Big sledgehammer-like axe handle with a skull.
And that right there is a little bit of seeing veteran over the rookie here, because King knows where he's at in the ring. The rookie may not yet.
Ashley Walker has no friends whatsoever. It's made that apparent very quickly. And Numero Dos, he keeps ducking and dodging, juking and jiving, and has Marcellus King in a very precarious position, although it would not be an elimination because Marcellus did not go over the top rope.
And I tell you what, look at this, Matty D extending the legs, big kicks, and
Damian Wayne, who's made a lot of noise about wanting the AWA World Heavyweight title or the Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight title, winning the Rumble would go a long way in doing just that.
It would set him in a position where he could name the title he wants. Now he's going to climb into the ring, and the first person he squares off with is Big Marcellus, the Mid-Atlantic King. We could have a battle of Mid-Atlantic Kings here.
We certainly do, and Jerry Wayne, I don't know what he was thinking, running to the arms of Damian Wayne. He hasn't had many matches yet at CWF Mid-Atlantic, but Damian Wayne certainly looks to have all the tools to be a huge force in the near future.
That's right, and you see Marcellus King turning his attention to number one, Matty D, and he is just beating him into the canvas. You gotta wonder how smart now Matty was at buying the number one, trading for number one.
Well, Matty wanted to push himself to the utmost limits, and that's exactly what he's doing. He's number one, and he's still in there, and Jerry Wayne better watch out because he's about to get going from behind. And here's the other two-thirds of the GD Rage, Roy Rage Wilkins, and Roy Wilkins, as Ray Kandrak gets eliminated, Roy Wilkins is the halfway point. He is number 15, Randolph.
That's right, that's 15 of the 30 people that's going to be entering this fray tonight for a chance to name their title shot, as we see Jerry Wayne deposited onto the concrete by Damian Wayne.
Damian Wayne certainly being a force here in the 600 Rumble. Roy Wilkins, before he can even get started, is in the arms of Marcellus King, but Roy Wilkins slips out from behind.
Marcellus King got his world rocked again by the rookie sensation, as we see Los Chivas Numero Dos ejected from the game.
Damian Wayne eliminates another one on his quest for a title shot of his choosing.
Tell you what, Roy Wilkins taking it from both Marcellus King and Damian Wayne right now. He better hope he gets a little friendly face coming out. Look at this. It's the Diamond, Casey McKnight.
Casey McKnight. Oh, that's down. And Marcellus King hung on. I thought Casey McKnight was going to make an impact early by eliminating Marcellus King, but Marcellus still alive.
Marcellus King lucky on that one. The Diamond using his brain, and that's what you've got to do to win a truck wreck like we're seeing in the ring right now. He's got a little bit of something for everything. Uppercuts for Damian Wayne. You see Marcellus King back in through the ropes. Ashley Walker still somehow. Well, there he goes out to the floor. Well, there it was.
The Rage eliminates Ashley Walker. Good job, Roy. Always proud to see Roy Wilkins achieve something. He has such spirit for being in this sport for less than 1 year.
Yeah, potential unlimited for that young man, but he's got to remain healthy. We've already had a little bit of a problem with an injury at the hands of who else, but we keep mentioning his name, but he's not here any longer. Michael Yamaha But right now, we got the next man in.
Oh, and we've got a big one now. It's a former winner. He won the 2004 CWF Rumble. It's Brad Attitude, one member of the original Dynasty.
Attitude in fists of fire against KC McKnight. And McKnight not sure exactly what to do here. And they are going at it. Attitude's unloading. Goes on to the next man. Damian Wayne tries to wave him off, but he takes a shot to the chest anyway.
Just like in 2004, Brad Attitude has taken on everyone in his way. Remember, that year, Brad Attitude drew number 7 and won it. He got a much better number here in 2006.
Yeah, he's got to be remembering that. Damian Wayne got hold of the Diamond, KC McKnight, trying to work him up over the top rope right now. I tell you, this is great. This is the 6th annual Indy Rumble, as we used to call it, the CWF Mid-Atlantic Rumble. You're only going to see it here.
An event born out of the horrible events of 9/11, the first ever CWF Rumble, was actually a benefit for the New York Fire Department, with every single dime that was drawn from the original Rumble going to the New York Fire Department. And now entering into the ring the first time in this one, another CWF Mid-Atlantic rookie, Mark Van Hook, as KC McKnight elevates Marcellus King, and a man that many had pegged as quite possibly a winner of this year's Rumble. Marcellus King, he drew a very tough number, and in the end, KC McKnight is the one that ends his night.
Tell you what, look at this. Brad Attitude, Damian Wayne going toe-to-toe here, sizing each other up. Wayne ducks under, and they are going at it.
Super kick by Attitude, and he helps out his good friend and member of the Dynasty, Rick Converse, by eliminating Damian Wayne.
KC McKnight's got somebody else up here in the corner. I can't tell who it is, but their body's starting to pile up on the floor and in the ring.
Yeah, Mark Van Hook is definitely in a world he wants no part of, because he is certainly outmatched at this stage of his career, but it's El Fuego. You got it, El Fuego, Jesse Ortega.
I tell you what, business picking up anytime Ortega steps through the ropes, because he will go toe-to-toe with anybody, anytime, any place, anywhere.
KC McKnight lined up with the rookie, Roy Rage Wilkins, two great youngsters of this sport. Right there's another one, Rock and Roll Matty D. You get enemies fighting enemies, friends fighting friends, because it all comes down to a shot at any championship you want.
And I tell you what, this rookie Van Horn in the corner is taking a beating. He is getting tenderized by both Attitude and Jesse Ortega.
Mark Van Hook earning his stripes early, and right now those stripes are etched across his chest, courtesy of Jesse Ortega.
Now Ortega, oh wait a minute, Van Hook tries fighting back, and all it does is just irritate Ortega.
Brad Attitude's final tap, and Alex Adonis. Now this, whether you love him or you hate him, this is a great story, Randolph, as he squared off against Jesse Ortega. It was 1 year ago tonight that Alex Adonis had his last professional wrestling contest. It was the 5th annual CWF Rumble. And on the ride home that night, Alex Adonis was in a horrible car accident. As Mark Van Hook's eliminated by Ortega, Alex Adonis' career was nearly ended the night of the CWF Rumble 1 year ago tonight. And 1 year later, he's returned to, I dare say, the scene of the crime to compete in the 6th annual Rumble.
Well, you know, from what I hear, his life nearly ended that night. I mean, we didn't see Alex for almost 7.5-8 months after last year's Rumble. And when we seen him just a few months back, he was on crutches. And you got to know, this is all adrenaline that's got him in the ring at this point right now. Anyway, I mean, I question, should he be in the ring anyway?
Well, I hate that his story cost Roy Wilkins his shot. Oh, we've got another rookie, and a rookie that I don't know right off. I would say his chances are not good.
Well,
it's Jersey Nick Richards.
I thought that guy worked at a sub shop. I know him. He's that kid that shortchanged me on my sub last week. Yeah, you show him, Brad. Rip that shirt off.
Well, Brad Attitude's taking it to him like he shortchanged Attitude as well.
Yeah, and he didn't put no mustard on my sub either. You show him, KC.
European uppercut by KC McKnight, as Brad Attitude is pulled out his short arm scissors in a rumble.
Oh, look at this.
And Ortega with the figure four.
And we've got three guys locked up and possible tap out conditions here. And what was that?
Jersey Nick Richards just made a very huge mistake.
KC didn't tip him or what?
How dare
Jersey Nick Richards slaps KC McKnight.
Look at that. He imploded the chest. Now, wait a minute. Ty Dillinger making his way. And I'm not going to let Ty do this. Oh, no. He's got Steve Green with him.
Certainly one of the more deplorable individuals mocking the Boogie Woogie Man, Rob McBride. Simply Steve Green, one half of the fake New Dynasty, is in the ring.
And look at this. What's Jersey Mike doing here? I mean, this is bizarre.
It's Jersey Nick right
now. No, he works at Jersey Mike's.
Steve Green and Jesse Ortega, certainly no love lost there.
I tell you what, they are going back and forth. You can hear these chops all around the arena. And I tell you what, they're going to be feeling this in the morning.
Of course, we're down to that portion of the Rumble where those that have the luck of the draw, the very good numbers, say 20 and up, are getting to enter now. And miraculously, Matty D is still alive and well.
Yeah, who thought we'd been saying that just a few moments ago? He was in dire straits.
Bobby Fonta, the man that was a hired henchman in last year's Rumble trying to eliminate Rick Converse, has returned to his scene of the crime at the 6th annual CWF Rumble.
That's right, Bobby Fonta getting softened up with shot to the spine by Ortega. You see Alex Adonis trying to eliminate Matty D again. I mean, how many people have we called trying to eliminate Matty D so far in this tonight?
It's very surprising. I tell you one thing, Matty D was sent on a mission when he got here. He drew number 29, he handed it in for number one. Whoever drew number one had the best luck ever. I mean, their night went from as bad as it gets to just about as good as it gets.
Well, what about the Sheik? You've already said the Sheik bought the number from Gemini Kid. I mean, how much better can that get to come in last?
Well, true, but yeah, I dare try even envision Sheik Lumpkin leaving with the title of his choosing as Jersey Nick Richards gets deposited by El Fuego Jesse Ortega, and Mr. Elite Jake Manning is on his way to the ring.
That's right. You tell Jersey Mike I didn't want pickles on that sub.
It's Jersey Nick.
Whatever.
Jake Manning, in all his glory, entering the CWF Rumble, driving the shoulder block into Bobby Fonta.
Yeah, and you're starting to see some of the larger competitors are able to stand tall, even though we've already lost Marcellus King. I mean, these guys are, there's no love lost between any of them. They all have history with each other here.
You can definitely see that the rookies have almost been weeded through to leave some of the true bears. Oh, Attitude hung on there, and right now he's trying to suplex Steve Green to the arena floor.
Steve Green holding onto that rope for life because it's, you know, being suplexed over out to the floor, that could be your life right there if he's the land wrong. Goes for the super kick. Steve catches.
Oh, a low blow by Steve Green eliminates Brad Attitude just before Attitude's tag team partner X Cyrus gets to the ring, and he goes straight to the aid of his partner.
That's right, he's checking out his partner on the outside. Steve Green posing up on the ropes, a bad place to be. Ortega's caught him up right trying to toss him out. Matty D still in this one, working on the back of Alex Adonis.
KC McKnight, he's been in there for a good time as well. Not as long as Rock and Roll Matty D, of course, but I believe KC was number 16.
Right now, Matty D working, clawing away at the face of Mr. Elite. And Alex Adonis catches him. I mean, yeah, like I said, this is getting kind of hard to call because this is starting to pile up like a wreck in here. X-Cyrus finally in.
Making sure Attitude was okay, and then he went straight to the man that cost Attitude this match, Simply Steve Green.
And Simply Steve Green holding on again for all it's worth as the counter counts down. See who else is going to enter this fray.
Oh, Tank Lawson! You talk about one of the odds-on favorites as Bobby Fonta trying to hang on for dear life. X-Cyrus comes with a super kick and Fonta's out of here. Tank Lawson, what a great number for him to draw.
Yeah, Tank Lawson's still got to be upset about what has transpired earlier in the evening with the former AWA Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight Champion and his tag team partner. And yeah, I'd say he just made 3 points in about 47 yards there with the wind blowing at him.
Oh, he just grabbed the leg of Alex Adonis. And Alex Adonis may be out of here short for the night, courtesy of Tank Lawson.
Tell you what, Matty D down on the apron. X-Cyrus kicking, pushing, doing everything he can, trying to get him down to the floor. Tank Lawson still wreaking havoc in the ring.
Just about dropped Steve Green around the back of his head as KC McKnight lays some shots in on Mr. Elite and Jesse Ortega for good measure.
Yeah, KC McKnight, pretty impressive so far. I mean, right now he's going straight to the face of any. Wait a minute.
The lights have gone out, and we've seen this before. CWF Mid-Atlantic. I hope it's just
number 27,
Solomon Sane. You got it.
Right in the middle of the ring, this bizarre character calling himself a member of the Black Watch. I mean, he doesn't look Scottish to me. I'm sorry.
The Black Watch is officially entered, and even though Michael McAllister did not last long in the Rumble, Solomon Spade eliminates KC McKnight.
One of his favorites over the top rope now, as you see Steve Green and X-Harris going at it. Tank Lawson going to go toe-to-toe. But Solomon Spade went straight to the eye.
Tank Lawson isn't going to play any mind games with Solomon Spade. It doesn't matter how spooky you may be, a thumb to the eye is going to make you very human very quick.
Yeah, regardless if your eye looks like a playing card denominator of some sort, as Tank slams Solomon Spade. We can see the counter is counting down. We're about to have another man enter the fray.
Champagne! We're getting down near the end, and one of the true icons of modern day Mid-Atlantic Wrestling has drawn a tremendous number.
That's right, Champagne in working in conjunction with Tank Lawson, flailing away on simply Steve Green. You gotta wonder, Champagne, that this is another one that had the odds looking in his favor, and the later you come into this match, the better those odds get.
Steve Green trying to hang on there, courtesy of, Tank Lawson, elbow right between the eye, and how good is it to see simply Steve Green get eliminated?
That's right, Champagne Jesse Ortega go over to Spades. Champagne's going to back off and let Ortega chop on him a little bit.
Ortega with Spades in hand is Tank Lawson. Two of the most popular individuals, Tank Lawson and X-Cyrus, actually battling it out now.
That's right, and here we go, Matty D. He's still in this thing. You gotta wonder for how long. See, it is struggle over here on this side. Ortega struggling with Solomon Spades. They're gonna eventually eliminate each other the way they're going. And
it's Mitch Connor as Ortega charges at Spades, and El Fuego's eliminated. And we've gotta mention number 29, Matty D, turned in number 29. And this is the man that originally had number one, Mitch Connor.
Handsome Mitch Connor, I tell you what. Amazing tag team championship run they had earlier in 2006. Very unpredictable, very talented young man. Quite surprising, and look at this.
Oh, Mitch Connor wasn't paying attention, and Matty D just about eliminated the man that he traded in numbers for.
I mean, he didn't even make an entrance. He could have climbed up on the ropes and about called it a night.
Tank Lawson and X-Cyrus, strange opponents, but they're still fighting it out.
That's right, Champagne, you see him delivering boots over here in the corner. Matty D still in this one by himself over in the corner. And in rushes Connor. Oh, it's Solomon Spades and Champagne is battling.
Oh, and here comes number 30 himself, Sheik Lumpkin.
Yeah, Sheik Lumpkin and King Kong Bundy's third grandchild.
Connor and Matty D, number 1 and number 29, still fighting it out.
Well, that's amazing, I tell you. I would have never
been. Oh, no! No, Matty!
That he would have made it all the way through all 30 coming into the ring, and technically he didn't because Lumpkin hadn't got in the ring yet.
Matty D, though, what a tremendous effort. He guaranteed victory. He had his heart set on some form of retribution after Yamaha bailed on this promotion as X-Cyrus deposits Jake Manning over the top rope. It was a great effort by Matty D, but really, what human being can go from number one?
I know I'm getting old and I got bad eyes, but what was Jake Manning smiling so big about when he got eliminated?
And now Lumpkin finally in the ring, and what a disgrace it would be for Lumpkin to leave this night as winner.
Look who he's trying to eliminate. Come on now, get real.
Well, I think he's going to need some help to leave his winner because he didn't have any luck against Tank Lawson. He's not having much better against X-Cyrus.
And you know Tank Lawson's got to be looking down at this skinny little manager thinking, you know, I really didn't expect this. I get a shot against this guy who tried to bring me into CWF Mid-Atlantic and try to get me to turn my back on the United States of America.
Tank Lawson with Lumpkin well in hand.
Big bodyguard on the outside can do nothing but stand there because he's not in this match. And look at this.
Boy, can go catch Lumpkin because Lumpkin's been eliminated. And you better believe no one lasted shorter in this year's Rumble than Lumpkin did.
Well, I mean, Last in, first out, whatever. I mean, whatever, right? Lumpkin's not known for his wrestling ability anyway. He's known for spending money that isn't his to put together a small... Oh!
Champagne deciding a battle with Hank Lawson would not be well-advised as Spades and Xyrus jockeying for position as we are down to the final five in the sixth annual CWF Rumble.
That's right, and Xyrus struggling with Solomon Spades trying to put him out over the top rope. Hank Lawson, he's going to come over and lend a hand here. We may be bringing this one down to four as Xyrus and Lawson both fighting and Solomon Spades' feet didn't touch the ground, and look at this, roll right back under, Xyrus starts stomping.
We certainly have five very eclectic individuals, both with their own style and their own way, and I would venture to say any one of these five could really win this one, Randolph.
I'll tell you what, look at this, Tank Lawson going back to this poke to the eye, setting up everything, slingshots Xyrus over the top rope. Xyrus is down. We're down to the final four.
I think a lot of fans may be upset to see Tank Lawson eliminate Xyrus, but that just demonstrates the power of Tank Lawson, and then he's going to take on anyone that attempts to win this one.
That's right. Looks like he's going to try to tie up Mitch Connor and eject him from the ring, but right now Solomon Spades still in control here. Shoots Champagne into the corner. Champagne up and over. Ducks a clothesline and delivers one of his own. Solomon Spades down.
We've got him paired off at Champagne and Solomon Spades. On one side, but we've got Mitch Connor, very mismatched against the powerful Tank Lawson on the other.
Oh, smart move, veteran move by Mr. Spades. That headbutt right into the midsection took the breath out of Champagne, caught him by surprise. Connor struggling, not having much success getting Tank Lawson off his feet or over the top rope.
The final four in the sixth annual CWF Rumble is coming down to this. Solomon Spades with Champagne fires him off. Drop toe hold. Champagne almost out of the ring, but it would not have been an elimination because it wasn't over the top.
Hey, watch that. It looks like he caught the face on the bottom rope right there. Solomon Spades knew what he was doing, knew it wasn't an elimination. That was designed to inflict pain.
Short arm clothesline by Spades takes Champagne down, and Mitch Connor doing everything in his power to try to eliminate Tank Lawson.
And I mean, Tank Lawson's expending no more energy at this moment than he would be lying in a hammock.
Champagne struggling, trying to get back up to his vertical base. Although almost in a rumble, laying down is almost as good as being on your feet.
That's right. I tell you, Mitch Connor over taking a beating at the hands of the big Tank Meister. And look at this, up to the top rope, Champagne, off onto Solomon Spades. He's starting to go for a pin here.
Yeah. Force of habit is that corkscrew Champagne has won many matches with. Took Solomon Spades down, but Mitch Connor was right there, right on top of him.
Yeah, looks like they changed partners in this square dance. It's Mitch Connor and Champagne are going at it. Tank Lawson back on Solomon Spades.
Lawson, Champagne sends Spades and Mitch Connor crashing into one another. Swinging neck breaker on Mitch Connor. And we got a Samoan drop by Tank Lawson.
Tank Lawson got that, pulled that one out of nowhere. Solomon Spades in a world of hurt. We've got two standing, two on the floor. This one's winding down, but I tell you, this is exciting as all the previous rumbles have been. And let's see, looks like we've got two of them. Tank Lawson's got hold of Mitch Connor. Oh, he flapjacks him onto the canvas.
Well, it certainly looks like Tank Lawson and Champagne may be the final two, the way they're teaming up together, although they squared off briefly, but once again, they pull back apart, going back to their adversaries instead.
And look at this. Tank Lawson trying to walk a mud hole through the chest of Mitch Connor. Got him down. Champagne down. Solomon Spades pounding across the back and the shoulders.
Reversal by Champagne. Well, Solomon hung on. Clothesline. Champagne. Solomon Spades. Both are eliminated.
Down to the final two already. Two men eliminated in one move. It's Tank Lawson and a very handsome man, Mitch Connor, who's flat on his back getting choked out.
Well, one of these two will definitely win the sixth annual CWF Rumble. After 30 men, it's come down to these two, and what in the world is Donnie Dollars doing back out of here? He's already been eliminated by Otto Schwartz previously. Big boots to Tank Lawson, courtesy of Donnie Dollars, while the officials were with Solomon Spades and Champagne, who are still battling at ringside, and there's Fatback himself, Brad Studs. Dropkick by Spades to Champagne outside the ring. Dollars is running around here. Studs is running around here. The officials have no idea what's going on. Donnie
Cena just broke him.
I do number one.
And this bitch Connor just looking at the camera and stating to himself, he drew number one and won it. The only difference is that Matty D traded in the winning number for the number that was held by Mitch Connor.
People, the changes were coming, and the first change is here. Ladies and gentlemen, the new Bad Bag Enterprise.
As Brad Stutz proclaims this to be the new Bad Bag Enterprise, if that is indeed the case, this is certainly one incredible way to revitalize Fatback Enterprises, as Mitch Connor has won quite possibly the biggest match in his life. Jake Lawson can do nothing but look on and watch as Brad Stutz and Donnie Dollars have robbed Jake Lawson of his win and handed it to Mitch Connor.
Team players all day long!
I'm the guy that just won the Rumble. You must be the
other guy. Fire up! I want this one! I want this one! Yeah!